We appreciate you being with us and had a good first experience. And so we know that the crazy group is in the second one. So we anticipate it will be even better. We are in week three of a series. And so there are some red containers on this side of the room. If you want to follow along and take notes, you can take one of these cards and pass it all the way across. And you can follow along, and I'm going to save the last 3 points for the end. So if you want to take notes, you can put those on there. I'm going to jump right into things this morning. And our series is called Godfidence. And we know this, that faith is trusting in something or trusting in someone. And so really what that is confidence. So we made up this word called Godfidence. And Godfidence is confidently trusting in the promises of God. Confidently trusting in the promises of God. That's what Godfidence is. It's not believing that God can. It is actually believing that God will. And so in week one, we learned how to develop a spirit of faith. And here's what a spirit of faith is. It is to hear the word of God and agree with it. It is to agree with it and decree it. And it is to decree it and do it. So hear and agree and decree and do. That's what a spirit of faith is. And Pastor Mitch did an awesome job last week sharing with you how you you take a spirit of faith and you deal with fear. And so this week and next week, don't miss a service because I'm going to share with you this week. Here's my title this morning, Godfidence for Physical Health. Next week, we're going to talk about Godfidence for financial wealth. And these are the messages that bring out the haters against me, okay? So hope you know this, that I'm going to teach you the Word of God, okay? The Word of God. And so if you will receive it and buy into it, I believe you have some brand new revelation this morning. Let's go to 3 John, and we're going to read verse 2, and we're going to read verse 3. Verse 2, a lot of people preach on, a lot of people create a lot of controversy around it, but if you connect it with verse 3, there is no controversy. Ready? This is John talking to a man named Gaius, and we're going to learn here the will of God for our lives. It says this, beloved. Anyone a beloved here? You say, well, I don't know. Well, what beloved means is you're one of God's people, right? So we're the beloved. So he's talking to who? You. Beloved, I pray that you may what? Prosper. Look at someone said, that's me. Beloved, that you would prosper. Here's what this word prosper means. It means to be in a state or a condition where you flourish. So it says this, brothers, I pray that you would prosper in all things or in all ways, and you would be in what? Health. Okay? So being prosperous is connected to what? Being healthy. So prosper, be in health. Look what it says, just as your soul would prosper. Okay? We're going to come back to that. Verse 3, for I rejoiced greatly when the brethren came and they testified of the truth that is in you, just as you walk in the truth, the Amplified says, truth that the gospel will produce. So we see right off the top here that it is God's will for you to flourish in life, right? It's God's will for you to flourish or to be in a state where you prosper. Now, but it's connected to something. It says prosper and be in health. So part of prospering, part of the will of God is that we be what? Healed and we be healthy. But look what it's connected to. It says just as your soul would prosper. In the New Testament, whenever we see the word soul, we have to know what that means. So the Bible says this, that you are made up of three parts, a spirit, a soul, and a body. When you got born again, your spirit got born again. That's the eternal part of you. That's the part that will go to heaven, that will live on eternally, okay? The body, the Bible says you also have a body. Now, when you got saved, your body didn't get saved. It won't get saved until Jesus comes back, right? But it also says you have a soul, a spirit, a soul, and a body. And your soul didn't get saved either. What is your soul? Your soul is the core of your life. It's where your intellect is. It's where your emotions are. It's where your will is. In other words, it's your mind. That's why the Bible says we have to be what? Renewed, remodeled in the spirit of our minds. And so your life prospering only prospers if what your soul does. In other words, you are always moving in the direction of your strongest thoughts. So the Bible says, have your mind, Romans 12, verse 1 and 2, have your mind transformed, have it renewed by what? The Word of God. So we have to have our, because we have what I call stinking thinking, right? We have stinking thinking, which means we just have a way that we think, and it needs remodeled to the Word of God, because we think contrary to the Word of God. So you become a Christ follower, you get born again, your mind has to follow, and it has to be renewed by the Word of God, and it has to be remodeled by the Word of God. Now, James chapter 1, verse 21 says this, if you receive the Word of God, it will save you. If you receive the word of God, it will save you. Interesting thing, that word save is the same word as this word prosper in this scripture. If you receive the word of God, you will prosper. If you receive the word of God, guess what? Your mind will prosper, or it will be in a condition or a state of what? Flourishing. So as your mind flourishes, your life will flourish. Right? So as our minds are renewed to the word of God. Now the key to this is verse number 3. Everyone creates controversy around verse 2. Well, does God really want you healed? Does God really want you prosper? Here's how we know that's true, and here's how we make sure that happens. Verse 3 says this, that in you, or just as you walk in the truth that the gospel produces. How many know the gospel is the truth, right? So if we're walking in the truth, the truth is what? Our soul prospers, and we can prosper in our health. We can prosper in our wealth. Thank you for your overwhelming enthusiasm about that. I thought maybe that would excite you more. So let's talk for the next few moments about this fact, having a real Godfidence in physical health. I want to preach to you the truth because it's the gospel, right? So if our souls begin to prosper, we know what the word says. We have our thinking changed. I believe our health changes. And so I believe if you have sickness in your body this morning, you'll be healed at the end of this service. Well, how can you? Yeah, you know why I can make that statement? Because that's what Jesus said. I'm just repeating. You said that's bold. Well, that's faith. That's what Jesus said, right? So we'll see here. Godfidence for physical health. Now, let's take this spirit of faith formula that I gave you to hear and agree and decree and do. Let's put that to a Bible test, right? Okay, so in Mark chapter 5, there's a story of a lady that we've all heard this story many times, but the Bible says this, that for 12 long years, she dealt with a condition. And the theologians will tell you it was probably something like a fibroid tumor that caused her to have painful bleeding continually. And so if you understand anything about that, that meant in their traditions, she was unclean. She couldn't be around people. She was an outcast. She was embarrassed. And the Bible says she spent all of her money on tests, trying to get a diagnosis, and on doctors. And the Bible said nothing got better, but it actually grew worse and worse and worse. So she had a bad diagnosis, and nothing was getting better. She threw all the hands of the doctor, spent all of her money. And let's look at verse 27 in Mark chapter 5. And we're going to see this faith formula work here. When she heard about Jesus, she came behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. For she said, if only I could touch his clothes, I might be well. She said, I shall be well, right? So she had some Godfidence. Immediately, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of this affliction. And so we see the faith formula working. What's the first step? To hear and agree. She said she heard of Jesus. What do you think she heard of Jesus? This is what I think she heard of Jesus. Acts says this, that he was becoming well known for this, that he went from town to town, village to village, and he preached, and he was teaching, and he was healing all of those oppressed by the devil. She started hearing Jesus was traveling. He was in town after town, village after village, and when he preached, and when he taught, and when he laid hands on sick people, they were healed. So what happens when you start hearing the words of Jesus? Your faith gets stirred. Just like you hear other reports, your fear gets stirred. You hear other diagnoses, your fear gets stirred. Now, it doesn't mean that a diagnosis isn't real, but we've learned this, that the truth of the gospel trumps the truth of a diagnosis, right? You might be having a physical diagnosis, but the truth of healing trumps that, right? You might be having a financial situation, but the truth of financial blessing always trumps that truth. Amen? So she's hearing about Jesus. As she's hearing, he's going town to town. So her faith is getting stirred. Why? Because she knows she's in the crowd where Jesus is. This is so important that we got to keep what? Hearing and hearing about things like healing. Because we will begin to slip from it. We will begin to put more faith in our symptoms than we do the Savior. We'll put more faith in how we feel than the Father. Amen? So she's hearing and hearing. And so I looked this up for you. There are actually 5 Greek words that talk about the conditions that Jesus healed. I'm not going to give you the Greek words. We're not going to all the scriptures. Just let me tell you what those 5 conditions that it specifically spoke that Jesus was going about and he was healing. The first one was the Greek word for terminal cases. If someone had a terminal case, she started hearing Jesus is healing terminal cases. The first Greek word that Jesus healed was terminal cases. Nothing is too terminal for Jesus. No diagnosis is not the end, is what I'm saying. She started hearing Jesus actually is healing people who they said there's no cure and it's a terminal situation. The next word for healing that Jesus did was conditions where people were crippled. She started hearing that Jesus was healing people that were terminal. Jesus was healing people that were crippled in their body. So see her faith getting stirred. Next thing, the next Greek word for healing that we see Jesus doing is for people who are facing mental oppression, suicidal thoughts, depressive thoughts, things attacking their mind. She started hearing that Jesus was actually setting people free from mental oppression, crippling conditions, terminal cases. The next one, the next Greek word is for reoccurring conditions. That would be things that they can't cure that keep happening over and over. Migraines, allergies, diabetes, these things that keep happening over and over and over. She heard Jesus heal those too. And the last one is those who are in the last stage, almost dead or comatose. So you got to think, what did she hear? Because the Bible says this, that she heard about Jesus. What did she hear about Jesus? Well, she obviously heard about his love. She heard about his power. She heard that when he preached the kingdom, things happened. She realized that when he taught the kingdom, things happened. And so she started hearing, he heals cripples. He heals terminal cases. He heals people who are at the point of death and they're comatose. She started hearing that people had reoccurring allergies and things. Jesus healed all five of those areas. And she started hearing over and over. So her faith began to be what? Stirred. Let me tell you this. When you get sick is not the time to find out if you believe in healing. When you get in a financial challenge is not the time to try to figure out what you believe. Right now is the time to build your spirit of faith. You need to open the word, look in the mirror, and begin to declare these things over your life. So the Bible said this, she heard about Jesus. So she came up behind him in the crowd. She grabbed his garment and she said, if only I can touch his clothes, I know I will be made well. So we see her hearing about Jesus. Now we see that the Bible says that she said, well, what did she say? She said, if I can touch his garment, I know I'll be, because what? She heard about the power. She heard about the healing. She heard about what Jesus was doing. She says, I've got to come into contact with that. And if I come into contact with that, I will be what? Healed. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord, anyone redeemed in here this morning? It says, let the redeemed of the Lord say what? So. So I tell people, do not go around saying, well, I'm a recovering this. No, you need to say, I'm free. I'm recovered. I'm healed. I'm free. I'm blessed. It's important what you say. She just said what she was hearing, what she was saying. I declare I'm healed. I declare I'm free. Despite the symptoms, despite the conditions, what was she saying? She was saying this, what the Bible says, that the benefits, the Bible said there are some benefits that we have, that what? He healed me of all of my diseases. She was getting in agreement and declaring what Jesus said. She said, if I can touch him, I know I'll be what? I wonder what our confession is sometimes. And what comes out of our mouth sometimes? You can't have a negative confession and get a positive healing. It doesn't work. You can't be in disagreement. Well, you know, sometimes God heals, sometimes it will, sometimes it's not. We got to what? You can't go by feelings. You can't go by an experience you had. You can't look and say, well, I know someone who didn't seem to get healed. You got to base it on what? The gospel. Because the Bible said the truth is the key. They followed the truth of the gospel. Therefore, their soul was renewed. Therefore, they could believe. Therefore, they could decree. Therefore, they could be in a condition or a state of flourishing. Hear and agree and decree, and decree and do. She reached out and touched him. Now, when you read it like that, it sounds like she was like, I don't believe it was like that. I don't believe that gets healing flowing. I believe that she was so moved, she continued to hear the words of Jesus. She was so stirred in her faith that she reached out and she grabbed a hold of Jesus and grabbed a hold of his clothes. That's what faith does. It doesn't just reach the tap. It reaches out and it grabs a hold of a promise and it says, I'm going through a physical thing. I believe I'm healed. I believe I'm separated, because you've got to hold on to a promise of God that's bigger than you, bigger than your symptom, bigger than your diagnosis, bigger than your condition. And the problem is it takes a little bit of effort to get through the crowd and hold on to a promise when the haters are against you and the symptoms are against you. You got to keep your faith. If you keep hearing and you keep declaring, that'll make you grab a hold of a promise, because everybody, especially religious people, will try to talk you out of a promise of God. And they'll tell you ridiculous things like this. Well, you must have sinned. That's why this is on you. Sometimes you don't do anything wrong and things come at you. It's a crazy world we live in with a crazy devil. So here's why I know she grabbed a hold of his clothes. She didn't just tap him. Look at verse 30. And Jesus immediately knew in himself that power went out of him. And he turned to the crowd and he said, who touched my clothes? See, that's how I know. Because if you just tapped, you don't know that. But if somebody grabbed a hold of your clothes, you ever had someone grab a hold? My daughter, I don't know why she does this all the time. She walked through the room and grabbed my sleeve. And always pulls my sleeve. I'm like, why do you do that all the time? Jesus knew someone grabbed a hold of him. And his disciples, who are full of faith, look what they said. Well, you see the multitude thronging you, and you say, who touched you? In other words, they were being sarcastic. Verse 32, Jesus looked around, and he saw the lady who had done this thing. And the woman was in fear and trembling, knowing what had happened to her. And she fell down before him and told him the whole truth. And verse 34, Jesus said, how dare you do this? How dare you think it was the will of God for you to be? How dare you hold on to it? How dare you do this? No, he didn't. And you know what else he didn't say? Well, the power that was in me flowing through me from the heavens above. He didn't say that. Look what he said. He said, daughter, your faith has made you well. He said, so you can go in peace and you're healed of your affliction. That's some interesting verbiage. Your faith in me made you well. There are 30 times in the New Testament where we see about healing and it's instant. There are 40 times when it's progressive. Most of the time, a healing is progressive. And many times, like the reason why I was so bold and said, when at the end of this service, I believe you could be healed. A lot of people lose the healing from here to there. They do. Because they don't have a spirit of faith. That keeps what? Agreeing. It keeps what? Standing in faith. Keeps what? Declaring. Keeps doing. This is interesting. 16 out of 19 times, Jesus said, your faith. He didn't say my. He said, your faith in me. Your faith set you free. Your faith broke that addiction. Your faith in me turned that diagnosis around. So a spirit of faith. It's not just our faith. It's our faith being developed and our trust, our Godfidence in him and his power, in his finished work on the cross. Let me tell you, if you've been around here for a while, you've heard me tell this story. If you're a little bit newer, this may be the first time you heard this story. But I'm going to tell you a story that blew my mind, but it gave me great revelation. So several years back, I had somebody that I knew several years ago, and they just started coming to our church. They left another church. They came here. I didn't invite them. They just left. They came here. They had this conversation with me. I feel like God brought me here. There's things happening here that I haven't seen happen in my life for years, and just no one's supposed to be here. This is awesome. They were here every Sunday. Their teenager got real involved in the youth, and just every week they were just so fired up about what they were experiencing with the Word, with the Holy Spirit, and all of a sudden they just kind of disappeared. And I didn't think too much about it, because that happens sometimes, right? And I randomly ran into them at the mall or somewhere, and they said to me, they said, the reason why I'm not in your church is when I went to leave the church I was at, they promised me if I would stay, I could have a microphone and be on the stage and be a singer on the front line. And I'm like, what do you mean? What do you say? Okay, it's great. I mean, I would never invite someone that goes to another church. So I said, okay, hey, cool. Hope things are good for you. And just moved on. Honestly, a couple months later, they dropped dead. Now, understand this. God didn't kill them. Don't walk out of here and say that I said that. But listen to what I'm about to tell you. They dropped dead. And it took me back. And I was actually outside shoveling snow. And I'm just praying. I'm like, God, what happened? What happened to them? Like, what in the world happened? And you know when you just know God spoke something to you? This is what God spoke to me. He said, I sent them to your church so they would hear about healing, because the church they're in won't teach it. So I sent them there to hear about healing so they would what? Be healed. Now, God didn't kill them. It wasn't punishment. I found out they had actually had several physical things before I didn't even actually know about. And I stepped back and I thought about, think about that statement, because God's God. Couldn't he just heal them? But God said, I wanted them to hear about healing so they would have faith to be made whole. That is an amazing statement. God wants to get you. That's why it's important that you're under the right word in the right place, because it might save your life. And I was like, I took a step back and thought, man, how important is it that I'm on track every Sunday? Because there might be someone sitting here that hears a message that it ends up saving their health, saving their marriage, saving their life. And I will never forget that story. Never forget that story, that God sent them here to hear so they could have faith. Maybe you're here today so you can hear, so you can have faith. So I believe this, that God heals. But why would it be that there are a lot of believers that don't walk in their health, don't walk in their healing? Tough question. I'm going to answer it for you. Go with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse number 29 and verse 30. In context, this is referencing communion and the body of Jesus, and our answer is right here. Verse 29, he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment on himself. Look at the last part. And they don't discern the Lord's body. What does discerning the Lord's body mean? It means you recognize that he was broken and bruised for your salvation. He shed his blood for your salvation. He was what? Stripes on his back were for your healing. And we quit looking to Jesus as the healer. And we look to other things and we talk sickness and we talk down, and we don't keep recognizing that Jesus was bruised. Jesus took stripes on his back for your healing. Because he took stripes, we're healed. We talk more about our ailments. We talk more about our pains. We say things like, my back is killing me, and my sacroiliac, and I don't even know what that is. We say things, is that something? Is that really something? I don't even want to know it. That's like an ugly picture. Anyways, so we say that we spend more time focused on our problems and focused on our symptoms than we do that Jesus is the one who makes us whole. Now, I'm talking about believers. Let me prove it to you. Look at verse number 30. For this reason, everybody say reason. For this reason, there are many of you who are weak and feeble, sickly, and asleep. So what does that mean? We're weak in our bodies, we have sickness, and we die premature. That's exactly what that means. Why? Because we are not knowing that Jesus is a healer. Our focus is off of him as a healer. And we spend more time, you listen to people. What do they talk about all the time? Sickness, disease, problems, pains, symptoms, over and over. We say it so much, we're expecting it. I mean, as soon as they say a new flu's coming out, what are we talking about? I'm going to get the flu. I get the flu every year. And let me tell you what, I don't want to hurt your feelings, but as soon as I'm done here this morning, someone will walk up to me in the hallway and tell me how bad their physical problem is. You won't now because you don't want to be that person, but that's normally what happens on a Sunday. Because there's somebody that does it every week, and they were in the service this morning, and they told me how good life was this morning. And I don't want to sound unsympathetic to you that you may be going through something, but we got to talk more health than we do sickness. We got to get our minds renewed where we think more health. Why can't we think and speak that God wants us whole? God wants us healthy. Yeah, there are going to be sometimes physical things come at you and challenge you, but our minds have to be renewed because we expect sickness. We almost plan for it. We just think we talk it. Out of the abundance of your heart, your mouth speaks. Why? And you think the person who speaks health and they speak healing and they're more alert about the words that come out of their mouth. We call them flaky. That's not the flaky person. That's the person that's full of faith. The Bible says we get sick and we get feeble. Why? Because we're not discerning what Jesus did on the cross. Listen to this. What you allow yourself to think, when you think things like God doesn't heal everybody, you retain it and it becomes part of your belief system. And the more you accept a thought as your own, the more it becomes the way you believe. You have a thought, you keep it, you retain it, you endorse it, and now it's the way you believe. And what you believe, whether you want it to or not, comes out of your mouth. And you start moving in the direction of your thoughts, and you move in the direction of your words. When you could be thinking different, staring at the body of Jesus, discerning the body of Jesus, knowing that he is a healer. And him being a healer is not based on your symptoms. It's not based on an experience you had, not based on some opinion that you had. It's based on the truth of the gospel, which is what verse 3 talks about. The truth of the gospel is how we live with a renewed mind. That's the key, is the truth of the gospel. The truth that the gospel produces. The word salvation is this little Greek word called sozo. It means you're delivered spiritually. It means you're delivered physically. It means you're delivered financially. The Bible said this, that sickness is part of the curse, and it was broken on the cross. So here's the last three things you need to write down at the bottom of this thing. Then we're going to take communion together. Number one, sickness. This is what you got to keep hearing, got to keep believing, that sickness is of the devil. God does not put it on you to teach you a lesson. God does not put it on you to train you. God, sickness is of the devil. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Addiction is of the devil. Sickness is of the devil. Poverty is of the devil. That stuff is of the devil. Remember our theology? God good, devil bad. That's all you need to know theologically. God is good, devil is bad. Someone's going, oh, we can study. I'm just giving you something funny to laugh at, all right? God is good, devil is bad. Every good thing comes from above. Thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Sickness is of the devil. Second thing you need to know is this, is that healing is the will of God. Healing, I mean, put your thoughts on this, put your beliefs on this. Sickness of the devil, healing is the will of God. The Bible says if you get into the word, you're going to know the will, and it's the will of God, what? Healing. And here's the third thing. Health is part of your redemption. Health is part of your redemption. Say, what's redemption? Well, redemption is when you got born again, you were redeemed. Jesus redeemed you from the curse of the law. You say, what's the curse of the law? The curse of the law is poverty, it's sickness and disease, and it's separation from God. And Jesus broke that on the cross. That's why the Bible said we discern the work on the cross, that he did what? Broke sickness, broke poverty, and he broke spiritual separation. That's what he did on the cross. That's what we discern that he did. Now, let me say this to you. I told my Dominion classroom this a week or two ago, that what you fail to enforce, you will always fail to enjoy. What you felt, that's tweet worthy, that's a tattoo worthy right there. Whatever you fail to enforce, you will fail to enjoy. And what I'm saying is this, God gave us a promise of healing, gave us a promise of health. If we fail to grab that promise, just like that lady grabbed the cloak of Jesus. Grabbed it. Why? Because she said, the Bible says she heard about Jesus. What have you been hearing about healing? She heard, so she said, and so she did. That's a spirit of faith. Keep hearing about healing. Keep declaring healing over your body. And keep moving in that direction. If you can't, if there's something keeping you from doing something, just start moving in that direction a little bit, because your life's going to follow your thoughts. So if your soul starts to prosper, your health will start to prosper. Amen? I mean, I've talked to just recently a few people in our church that were given a bad diagnosis, and they're healed in this service this morning because they have a spirit of faith. Now, I'm not saying it's them. I'm saying they had a spirit of faith that when something came at them, they were able to stand. And eventually, the God report overweighed the diagnosis. God's not a respecter of person, right? But what is he a respecter of? Our faith. I want you to know that your sad story, even though it's a painful story, is not what moves the hand of God. What moves the hand of God is our faith. That's why we need to develop a spirit of faith. So saying all this, what is it that I want you to grab this morning? It's this: sickness is of the devil, healing is of God, and health is part of your redemption. Isaiah predicted it. He said, the stripes that will be on his back are for your healing. Matthew looked at it and he said, I see what Isaiah said. I'm watching the stripes. They're for my healing. Peter remembered it and he said, by those stripes, I was healed. When were you healed? At the cross. When was that promise provided? At the cross. So you're saying to me, Pastor Aaron, that we can walk a healthy life? Yeah. Actually, I didn't say it. I just repeated what John said that God told him to write down in the Bible. I'm just repeating what Jesus said. A couple weeks ago, that flu thing was going around. It kind of hit me. It actually hit me on a Sunday morning. A lot of people said they didn't know, but I was like sort of everywhere in my head on Sunday morning. I was sweating. I was aching, all that stuff. And one of our guys that go here, he's a nurse. And he said, hey, he goes, go get this. Start taking this. Get it in your symptom. Get it in your body. I started taking them, and I started taking me some Isaiah 53. If the doctor said, take three of these three times a day, don't you do it. How about you take some of this three or four times a day? And so I started just speaking, started dealing with it. And you know what happened? I felt terrible. Well, that's what happened. I was pushing through. I was speaking. Actually, I had to go home from work one afternoon and sleep for a couple hours. But it took a couple of days. Finally, it broke off of me. But I kept having to what? Stand. It doesn't say you won't have a web. It doesn't say you won't have a symptom. But what? Just stand. I was standing because I had a spirit of faith. And it started coming on me. It took a couple of days to get off of me. And it was nasty. A lot of people have had it. But what happens? I wasn't going to agree with sickness. I wasn't going, oh, it's hitting me. I'm down. I didn't send an email out to the church. Pray for your pastor. He's got it bad. Oh, it's bad. It's the old devil's after me. I must be living wrong. No, I just kept standing on the word, taking me some of those cold pills and taking me some Isaiah, and finally got it broke off of me. Anyway, it was a nasty little thing. Now, you should have, when you come in, got some communion elements. If you didn't, if you